1894, the Russian Empire stretched from Poland to the Pacific, from Turkey to the Arctic. Tsar Alexander III was a man of peace, but in the 13 years of his reign, there was no social reform. Millions of peasants lived in feudal communes, uneducated, impoverished, exploited. Linked to their Tsar by the holy mysteries of the Orthodox Church, by whose divine right he ruled as supreme autocrat. The Tsar and his government, the court and society, lived in the remote city of St. Petersburg. Here they spoke French, wore dress uniform and jeweled gowns, drank wine, and enjoyed music, the theatre, the Russian dance. Among them, the heir to the throne, Tsarevich Nicholas. Tsar Alexander III lived apart in his great palaces, guarded by his generals and advised by his chosen ministers.
You want more railways. You always want more railways.
Russia moves at the pace of a horse and cart, Your Majesty. 100 million people at the end of cart tracks. Smaller European countries have more.
We are not a European country. Railways disturb people, Vitter. They're like seditious writing. They make them think they can get somewhere better. Where do you want to build a railway?
Across Siberia, to Vladivostok.
How many miles?
About 3,000 from Moscow.
How many rubles a mile?
I can raise loans, form private companies. We need the resources. If Austria send an army against
us... If the Austrian army attacks us, that's what we'll do to the Austrian army. Well, it's your business, Vitter.
No, Your Majesty. It's the Tsar's. Everything is the Tsar's business and must be seen to be.
So, what's in your mind?
An imperial president of the railways board.
The Tsar does not sit on committees.
His heir might.
The Tsarevich? Have you ever had a serious conversation with him? He's a child still. He has the judgment of an infant.
Nothing moves.
It's a cold night.
I mean, there's no movement in political life. Everything stands still.
Why not? We have peace, and we're attracting foreign capital. What's wrong with stability?
Oh, nothing, except that Jews are persecuted, intellectuals are silenced, and peasants are driven by starvation into the towns and then starve there.
Work there.
Oh, a few. In your factories. It's quite clear what ought to be done.
And what ought to be done, Professor Milyukov?
There ought to be a parliament.
Russia's too big. Oh. And too backward. I regret it, but there it is. Gradually, she'll become more civilized, perhaps in another century. better communications and so forth.
Oh, more railways. Your ideas are all mechanical. But one cannot have industrial change without social change. And you don't have to be a revolutionary to believe that men have the right to be consulted about their own lives.
Is that what you teach your students, Professor?
Hardly matters what I teach my students. They're not allowed to meet or talk or publish. For years now, this country has stagnated while one strong man tells us what to do.
He has good advice. Most of it is mine.
Well, autocrats are not eternal, however heavily guarded.
And there is no revolutionary party at present in Russia.
Because no one dares to lead it.
Will you?
Well, one can make reforms.
No. No, I'm nearer to you than you think. But one cannot wantonly break the system. That leads to revolution and anarchy.
You must have a pancake.
Why?
If the police come in, we're celebrating Shrove Tide.
Thank you.
Nadezhda Krupskaya.
Vladimir Ilyich Ulyanov.
They're all comrades. We meet when we can to talk.
I've observed that they talk.
We read Marx, we discuss socialist principle, we write pamphlets. We can't print them, we circulate them by hand.
To whom?
To each other.
Incest.
Where do you come from?
Samara, and before that, Simbirsk.
Why have you come to Petersburg?
To work.
At what?
At law. And for the revolution. But not this way.
Are you related to Alexander Ulyanov? The martyr.
He was my older brother.
Oh,
No. His death was useless.
How can you say his death
was
useless?
His pancakes are very good. Thank you. Good. The role of the worker. Have you ever met any workers?
Yes. I teach at Smolensky Sunday Evening Adult School. It's important to fight against illiteracy. Why do you laugh?
If anyone thinks he'll save the fatherland by fighting illiteracy, I won't stop him. Do they talk to you?
They tell me about their illnesses, their families, their problems. Yes, they do talk to me. One man told me he had discovered there was no God, and now life was easier. Because if one was the slave of God, one could do nothing. But if one was only the slave of men, then one could fight.
That is right. But with this, Tsarism won't be overthrown by assassination or by talk, only by the combined will of the people. Do they tell you about their working conditions?
Well, we have to be careful because they're always police spies. But I have seen the factories where they live like cattle among the machines. And I have seen the overcrowded dormitories. Men, women, children, the barely living and the dying. I can talk with them.
Good.
What should we do?
Study the factory laws. Talk to the workers. Question them. Find out what their grievances are. Then we can use those grievances in our propaganda. You must find ways of distributing leaflets, arrange contacts, meetings. When they see that we are identified with their everyday needs, then they will trust us. We can organize them, develop their political consciousness. You'll do nothing if you sit here and talk like effete university liberals. We must go out, obtain the confidence of the people and the power of the people. Only they can challenge the Tsarist state and the bourgeoisie which supports it. We must show the people the structure of society so that they can pull it down with their bare hands.
Dance for us, Matilda.
Oh, no, not now. No. Let's go on. I am the
not a cigana.
Fanny, one mazurka, then we go home.
Mm, we'll clap for you.
Yes. Come. Come.
What is all this? What is going on here?
Who is it?
It's the prefect of the city.
What do you want? How dare you come in here like this?
Your Imperial Highness.
Get out.
I have a dream sometimes, or rather a memory.
Of what?
My grandfather's death. I was 12. He'd been driving along the Katerinsky when someone threw a bomb at his carriage. They carried him into the Winter Palace we were all staying in, into one of the anterooms. We all went in to see him. There was blood on the floor. His right leg torn off. All the lower half of his body shattered. One eye was missing and his face was covered in blood. He made no sound. But he was alive. Until the doctor said he was dead. Granny was weeping by his side. Ma was just standing with her skates. She'd been skating.
Come.
She and Papa went out without taking any notice of me.
They called him the Tsar Liberator. He freed the serfs. And that's what they do to him. Papa said there shall be no more reforms. And he's right, the only way to rule this country is by strength. We all fear Papa, but we love him. They tried to assassinate him too, you know, but they won't succeed. Once, when our train was derailed, we thought it was a bomb, but it was only a mishap. The roof of the carriage collapsed and Papa held it up while we all climbed out. He looked like Samson.
Oh, your papa is very kind to me. At the theatre, he always comes and congratulates me on my dancing. Oh, those things don't happen nowadays. And when you are Tsar, everyone will love and admire you. Only...
What?
You don't have the knack of making your opinion felt. You give in to others far too easily when you are right.
Oh, I don't know. Perhaps I'm shy. Except when I'm with you. Everyone around me is so strong. The Romanovs are all giants, except me. That's why I hate going to parades on foot. I look so small.
Nicky, you're late for tea.
Sorry, Mama. We've been skating.
And then we threw snowballs at each other. Ran around like fools.
Your father has been speaking to the prefect.
Oh.
He's very angry with General Val for behaving as he did. But he's angry with you, too. Really, Nicky, you must remember, everyone's eyes are on you, watching everything you do. You must always be polite and courteous.
Yes, Mama. Thank you.
Your father looks to you.
Papa never takes any notice of me. unless I do something to displease him. If I'm given nothing to do, why shouldn't I spend my time with friends? As it is, I get very bored.
Your father looks to you to do what's correct. He's not been well, Nicky. We must think of the future.
I can't imagine anything changing for years and years and years.
Nicky, you are 26. You must marry.
That's all I'm fit for, in his eyes.
Don't be a silly boy. Drink your tea. It'll get cold.
Well, there's no one of royal blood I want to marry.
But it's your duty to. Princess Margaret of... Helene of Bourbon.
You know there's only one princess in the whole of Europe I at all care for.
She is not suitable.
So you and Papa say, but I'm very fond of her.
She is a Lutheran.
Aunt Ella changed her religion to marry Uncle Serge.
Your father and I would forbid it. She's an unsociable girl and a German.
Very well, if it can't be Alex, then there's no one.
This ballet dancer, Kashinska. Are you obsessed by her?
No, Mama. But I'm very fond of her, too. Life's so complicated and difficult. Why can't I marry who I like? I hope Papa will go on living for years and years.
But one day, Nicky, you must succeed.
I don't want to.
You are the born heir.
I've told him there's only one I'll consider. And that's Alex of Hesse-Darmstadt.
Are you in love with her? You hardly know her.
I've known her since I was 16. And she was only 12. She came to Petersburg when her sister Ella married Uncle Serge. She stayed 6 weeks.
Do you love her?
Not when I'm with you. She loves me, I think.
How do you know?
She writes to me. Papa doesn't like her. And there are religious difficulties, but if I can't avoid being Tsar, and it seems that I can't, I shall have to have a wife.
May I request your Imperial Highness not to smoke in my bedroom?
Sorry. Anyway, she may not have me. But I shall have to ask her.
When?
Our brother's to be married in Coburg, and I've been given permission to represent Papa. I shall propose to her then, whatever they all say. Before Easter.
And what's to happen to me? What is to happen to our love?
Annie, we always knew. Oh, it's so difficult. I have to marry, and she is beautiful and good.
And I am bad and ugly, Some little gypsy whore no one ought to know about. I am premier danseuse of the Imperial Ballet. Petipa has written a ballet for me. Tchaikovsky came to my dressing room, congratulated me, wanted to compose music for me, but he died. The European press have called me a star. But I am one of the people. I am not a princess or a foreigner. Oh, Nicky.
Nothing may happen. Nothing may come of it. When I return from Coburg, nothing may have changed. Whatever happens, I shall still see you.
All the Tsars in the past have had mistresses. Whoever they married.
Except Papa.
My poor Nikoshka.
Look. It's spring. It's 1 degree above zero. The thermometer went up 4 degrees in the night.
Yes, Nicky. It will soon be Easter.
We shouldn't have let him go. The French will think we're tying ourselves to the Germans and the English. Should marry a Russian princess. There are 28 royal ducal families to choose from.
There is no time.
Dear darling Mama, the weather was absolutely ideal, but it was very hot in the train. We crossed the frontier at 6:30 and all had supper together, Uncle Serge, Aunt Anna and I. Half an hour before reaching Coburg, we changed into uniform. At the station, we were met by Uncle Alfred, Aunt Mary, Alex, Ernie, Missy, Ducky, Alfred, and other less important people. There was a guard of honor of the 95th Regiment. I found Alex grown even prettier. She looked extremely sad. She was alone in Aunt Ella's rooms. I tried to explain to her that she must give her consent and simply could not withhold it, but without any result. She could not bring herself to accept a change of religion. At 4:30, Queen Victoria arrived and was received with great pomp. We saw it all from the windows of our apartments where we awaited her in full uniform.
Darling Ella, my dear child.
Grandmama.
Serge.
I trust your Majesty is well.
Yes, I am well. And Nicky. We will speak later. I wish to talk to Ella now.
Your Majesty's pleasure.
We'll make ourselves scarce, ma'am.
It's so peculiar being here after all these years. When poor Albert and I came, he stood at the train window pointing everything out. Your poor dear grandpapa never knew any of you young people. You were all born after he died. If he could only see, he would be so happy.
Do you think he would have approved of so much marrying of cousins?
The same blood only adds to the strength, dear. They might otherwise marry some unhealthy little prince or princess of another family who would probably cause just what one wishes to avoid, like poor Rudolf of Austria. The Habsburgs do not have good blood.
You know, Nicky wants to marry my sister.
Oh! This will be a fine match for her. You should speak to her. We must all speak.
His father and uncles do not approve.
That is not important.
Kaiser Wilhelm arrived at 6:00. He was most affable and sympathetic, and thinks it would be an excellent idea to have a German princess as future Empress of Russia. All the English and German relatives give me their good wishes. Yesterday, at the instance of Willy, the whole family was photographed in the garden. This morning, Wilhelm had a talk with Alex while I stayed in the next room.
Nicky! Go and talk to her.
No.
Faint heart never won, fair lady.
When I went into her, she was much more composed. I repeated what I'd said before, and with her very first word, she consented. She's quite changed. She's gay and amusing and talkative and tender. The whole world seems different to me. Nature, mankind, everything.
And I love you.
When I'm with you, half my fears and sadness disappear.
Only half? I want you to be quite sure of my love for you.
I'm more sure of you than I am of myself. I've never had any deep feelings about anyone before. I love Mama and Papa, of course. And I've often enjoyed myself too much. I've given way to drinking and women and so on.
We are all tempted. And when we are young, we cannot always fight against it. But if we truly repent, God will forgive us.
I've been keeping a mistress. She's a dancer, prima ballerina of the Royal Ballet. She's very young and pretty. Well, every summer we go to Krasnoye Sela for the Tsar maneuvers and, well, there's a little theater there. And it's a Petersburg Ballet come to entertain us, and it's all very gay and informal, and the officers get to know the dancers. Well, I helped her buy a house. I'm sorry.
Is it over?
Yes. It's over.
Caught your love and bound its wings. Thank you for telling me your secret.
You mustn't be shocked by life in St. Petersburg. It's not like England or even Germany. Papa and the family are like the owners of an estate. All Russia is ours to do what we like with. Everyone else, however rich and handsome.
In summer, when it's very hot, the plains in the south are all yellow and dusty and covered in heat haze. And the mountains are green with forests, and the roads go on and on. You can travel for days and weeks without coming to the end of it. Only little towns and villages. Great distance.
One day it will all be yours.
Yes.
I shall help you, and God will give us wisdom and strength.
I have a new ballet called Paquita, with music by Linkos. Chiquetti says I shall have a great success. Chiquetti says. And I have found a little villa near the barracks by the Dudehof Lake. It's lovely.
I hope you'll have a nice time there.
Are you not coming to Krasnoye Sela?
Well, I may come occasionally and see you dance. If the others do, I have to be with my family. I've come to say goodbye, Penny. Please don't cry. I'll never forget the lovely times we've had together.
Oh, you'll forget them, but I shall not. I will be your loyal subject. One of the many millions of them.
Please don't be angry.
Can't you tell anger from misery?
I didn't know how to say it more gently.
Oh, I know you are gentle. You don't like to see people hurt. You hurt them, but you don't like to see it. How many will you?
I'm sorry.
Oh, don't be a fool, Nikolshka. We always knew this would happen. Only, if I am ever in really great trouble, can I see you?
Tell Serge Mikhailovich he'll look after you.
Yes, he's nice. I hope your bride will bring you happiness. God go with you.
Thank you. For remembrance.
Thank you.
Goodbye.
That summer, the unimaginable happened. Alexander III became mortally ill. Those who realized faced the future with new hopes and new fears.
They're gathering round. Not like vultures, like sheep.
And if he dies?
He will die. And then God help us all.
Have you spoken of the Tsarevich?
No.
I implore you to.
Why, Professor?
We must have a new start. It's the only hope for Russia.
Oh.
A change of attitude from the throne.
It's not in my power. I wish it were. Imperial Grand Dukes are arrogant fools. Tsarevich is an ignoramus and his fiancée a pious little German nonentity. There'll be no initiative from that quarter. Only I shall lose a friend.
Make others.
You want a parliament? A national convocation of gas bags.
There must be some representation.
Of responsible people like Professor Milyukov.
There must be some representation before it's too late. Look, we're entering a new century with new ideas. Now read this. I brought it to show to someone in authority.
What is it?
They're being distributed illegally in the factories.
The workers' cause.
That's all very practical. How to form action groups, what the pressures are, how to resist fines, how to start strikes. There's a fresh mind at work.
It will be flushed out.
Of your factories. A new Tsar's Cossacks setting on the workers. Is that what you want?
No.
Then there has to be another answer. Otherwise, we shall all be forced to join them.
Will you join them? Professor.
Everyone who loves his country and who sees clearly.
Ah, who does that? Let me read it. I can't show this to the Tsar. Not now. It's incitement to anarchy. I'll speak to the Tsarevich when I can. I would leave it alone if I were you. It comes from a darker brain than yours.
Can you read that?
Just.
It's ridiculous having to copy all this by hand. We should have it printed.
We could get help from one of the groups in the liberal movement.
No. Don't trust the liberals. They will betray you.
Then I'll ask Lydia to take it to the Narodnaya press again.
Yes. Let's hope they can print it before the police close them down. We need time. Look, if I'm arrested, you'll have to keep the factory committees in touch with each other. I'll teach you the code when I've done this.
Why should the police be on to you already?
By my name. They'd think I want to assassinate the Tsar.
Like your brother. Why don't you ever talk about him?
The bomb he was carrying didn't even go off. He was arrested before he got anywhere near the Tsar. He could have saved himself. But he refused. My mother came to St. Petersburg to see him. She traveled half the way by cart, alone. None of our liberal friends would go with her. They hanged him without telling her. Ah, no one would have anything to do with us after that, and we had to leave Simbirsk.
Did you agree with him, Ilyich?
I realized something had to be done, but I knew even then it was the wrong way. We have to work, plan, and organize for the revolution, no matter how long it takes. Where have you got to?
A page behind you. They say the Tsar is very ill and has gone to the Crimea.
Makes no difference. There'll be another one. Let's hope that'll be the last.
At the end of the summer, the dying Tsar and his family left St. Petersburg and settled on the imperial estate at Livadia. In the sunshine of the Black Sea coast, amidst the beauty and quiet of the Crimea, the court was hushed with grief and dismay.
Hello, Mama.
Hello, Nicky. Constantine.
Good morning, Aunt.
Well, what have you been doing?
Oh, nothing. Constantine and I have been up on the roof, throwing chestnuts at each other.
I'll see you later, Nicky. Goodbye, Aunt.
Would you like some?
Yes, thank you.
How's Papa?
Oh, he's slightly brighter. He still feels sick, and his legs are painful.
Is there anything I can do?
No. Oh, no. Uncle Vladimir has come, and Father John will be here soon. Some of the ministers have arrived.
I've sent for Alex. She should be here soon.
Oh, good.
Papa got up and put on his uniform and blessed her and was very nice to her and confirmed our betrothal. My superb Alex seems more wonderful every day. Did you have a dreadful journey?
Yes. Well, no arrangements were made for us. I had to travel by ordinary passenger train. None of the officials spoke German or French. We had trouble with the luggage and terrible delays.
Never mind. You're here now.
I feel such a stranger. My feet hurt.
How's that? Better?
Yes. Shall I ever see you?
Of course, every day.
If you're not too busy.
There's nothing for me to do except sign letters.
What letters?
Oh, I don't know. I don't have to read them. I just sign for Papa when he's tired. Mama and the uncles and the ministers arrange everything.
You must be firm, Nicky. Make the doctors come to you every day. Let you know how they find him and exactly what they wish him to do. Make them come direct to you. Don't let the others be put first and you left out. You are Father's dear son and shall be asked first and told about everything. Show them your mind. Do not let them forget who you are.
I'll try.
Oh, forgive me, lovey.
The Tsar is going to die. Your Highness will have to think of the future.
I do. All the time. I'm facing the thing that I've feared all my life.
There are state papers to be signed and read.
Yes, I can do that. At present, I know nothing, but when the time comes, I shall do my duty, whatever it is, as well as I am able.
When your Imperial Highness comes to the throne, there will be pressure from many quarters for reform.
Yes, I expect so.
The local assemblies will ask for more power, and a popular assembly with access to the throne. I mean, a parliament.
Parliament? Oh, no, no, no. Those are senseless dreams.
They may be senseless, but they're what the people do dream. Your father has always ignored them.
Yes, and so shall I.
Your Highness, I am not a Democrat. I am not a liberal reformist or a revolutionary. But I know the world, and the world changes. Thank you. You may inherit your father's insignia, but you cannot live in the past.
I have no intention of doing
so. I am glad of that, because with respect, Your Highness is not strong enough. The future is not solid. It is full of gaseous intentions, explosive thoughts. Men are not animals. They have their own ideas. Give them some opportunity to express them. A hope, however small, however slow, of personal progress. And they will be your loyal subjects.
They are our loyal subjects.
Do not understand.
No?
When there is famine, they die. But when there is prosperity, they have little joy of it and are no longer content. They look to the Tsar for some relief, for some communication between them and the state. If the Tsar does not give it, others will.
Others?
I think, Your Highness, the lead will come from intellectuals in the towns. People in cities do not remain children. All the repression in the world cannot keep them innocent forever. There are aspects in modern life which can be turned to good or evil. I beg you, sir, not to start your reign at odds with the good in society. There are darker, more violent forces in the land. Marxists, anarchists, and other subversive doctrines. If you do not listen to the advice of moderate, liberal-minded men, then society will turn to those. And autocracy will be finished.
You are asking me to share the authority that God has given me, and which God knows I do not want.
To a small extent.
You too think that I am not capable. No, Vitter, I shall take advice as I think best from those already around me.
Around you? The court? The court is like the court of the Sleeping Beauty, full of cobwebs, inert, embalmed. You must wake up, or that sleep will become death.
Please understand that I will not shirk the responsibility that is my inheritance. I intend to maintain, as firmly as my dear father, the absolute autocracy bestowed on me by God.
Then your highness will have to rely upon miracles.
Sunny? I was waiting for Nikki.
Alone?
Yes. Yes, I mostly left alone.
While the Tsar is dying, their thoughts are naturally...
But I am ignored. While Nikki is dictated to by the ministers. I was sent for as the future Empress of Russia, and they take no notice of me.
Oh, you'll be going home soon.
I'm going to be married. At once, as soon as this is over.
That's impossible.
Why?
Oh, the royal dukes would never permit it.
You mean that Uncle Serge and Uncle Vladimir will decide?
And Paul and the others?
When Nikki takes his father's place, he will decide.
That's not how it will be. There will be a year of mourning while you wait in Darmstadt and prepare yourself. Then, you will come back for Nikki's coronation and your wedding, and everyone will accept you.
I'll never leave him, Ella. He needs me.
You will do him no good by staying.
And we love each other.
You're not marrying a private man. You are marrying Russia. And you must learn to be patient and often humble.
Why should the Tsar's wife be humble? Nikki will do what he knows to be right, and not what misguided men may advise him. He will follow divine guidance, and I shall help him.
Oh, Sonny, don't be a fool. Go home.
I'm going to be received into the Orthodox Church.
You know nothing about Orthodoxy.
You forget. I have been receiving religious instruction for 6 months from Father Yanishev. My heart is converted, and I have felt the mystery of God in it.
The church is like everything else here. There is light and faith. I have found them. They're covered with the smoke of incense and with barbarity. In the villages, there's no understanding, only superstition.
I don't care.
The priests are ignorant and destitute and live in sin.
There are always abuses.
Oh, they are not abuses. That's the way in Russia. The records of confessions are read by the police. The Holy Synod is used as an instrument of government, and the Tsar's authority rests on it. Alex, if you go with Nikki to St. Petersburg, the people will say you come behind a coffin and will bring bad luck.
But that is nonsense.
You will not be understood, nor will he.
I shall not leave him.
Therefore, in the name of God, we proclaim you Nicholas II, Emperor and Autocrat of all the Russias, Tsar of Moscow, Kiev, Novgorod, Kazan, Astrakhan, of Poland, of Siberia, of Taurochersonese, of Georgia, Lord of Pskov, Grand Duke of Smolensk, of Lithuania, Volhynia, Podolia and Finland, Prince of Estonia, Livonia, Karelia, Tver, Lord and Grand Duke of Rostov, Yaroslav, Kondia, Vitsp, and all the region of the north, Lord and Sovereign of the Circassian Princes and the Mountain Princes, Lord of Turkestan.